We did this song yesterday for a very special friend of ours, Luann, whose memorial service was. So in honor of Luann.
Thank you. Well, everybody gonna have religion in glory. Everybody's gonna be singing that story. Everybody's gonna have a wonderful time up there. Oh, glory, hallelujah. Brother, there's reckoning coming in the morning. Better be ready, I'm giving you the warning. Everybody's gonna have a wonderful time up there. Now listen, everybody, cause I'm talking to you. The Lord is the only one to carry you through. You better get ready, cause I'm telling you why. The Lord is coming from his throne on high. Going down the valley, one by one. Gonna be rewarded for the things we've done. How you feel about the things you said on that judgment day. Well, everybody gonna have religion and glory. Everybody's gonna be singing that story. Everybody's gonna have a wonderful time up there. Oh, glory, hallelujah. Reckoning coming in the morning. Better get ready, I'm giving you the warning. Everybody's gonna have a wonderful time up there. Now get the Holy Bible in the back of the book. The book of Revelations is a place to look. And if you understand it, and you can if you try, the Lord is coming from his throne on high. Reading in the Bible about the things he said. He said he's coming back to raise the dead. Are you among those chosen few? Will you make it through? Everybody's gonna have religion in glory. Everybody's gonna be singing that story. Everybody's gonna have a wonderful time up there. Oh, glory, hallelujah. Brother, there's reckoning coming in the morning. Better get ready, I'm giving you the warning. Everybody's gonna have a wonderful time up there.
I feel the touch of his hand, so warm and tender. They're leading me in the path that I must trod. I have no fear, for my Jesus, he walks beside me. And I'm sheltered in the arms of God. So let the storm rage high, the dark cloud rise on. Worry me, for I'm sheltered safe within the arms of God. He walks with me, and not a word can harm me. For I'm sheltered in the arms of God. Soon I shall hear his call from the portals. Come home, my child. It's the last mile you must try. I'll fall asleep, then I'll wake in God's new heaven, yeah. Sheltered safe within the arms of God. So let the storm rage high, the dark clouds rise and lay low. Worry me, for I'm sheltered safe within the arms of God. He walks with me, and not the bird can harm me. For I'm sheltered in the arms of God. So let the storm the dark must rise, they don't worry me, for I'm sheltered safe within the arms of God. He walks with me, and not a word can harm me, for I'm sheltered in the arms of God.
Yes, I'm sheltered in the arms of God.
Good morning, everybody. Yeah, welcome to Peace Evangelical and Reformed Church. We're here to worship the Lord and give Him glory. And as we have the voices of peace leading us in worship, we have the Word of God. And as we begin our time together, just some brief announcements to highlight. This week is Mike and Alyssa Schmelter's wedding anniversary. Also, birthdays this week, McKinley Fisher, Amy Johnson, Brad Zenner, their birthdays are today. Also this week, Brenda Van Dalwick, Jody Lenz, Caitlin Westbrook, Steve Gazer, Elsie Slotke, Trevor Hintz, and Sam Schusler. So happy birthday. Okay. Also a big, hearty, warm thank you for all those who volunteered yesterday to take down the nativity scene and restore it, and you did it in the ice-cold morning weather. We appreciate your work and there's a lot of cars here yesterday. Thank you so much for taking down the nativity set. Our annual meeting is next Sunday, January 23rd, immediately following the worship service. Women's Bible study resumes this Tuesday at 6:30 p.m. They will begin viewing The Chosen, the Christian TV series, as an exploration of the life of Jesus. Also, breakfast and Bible study group will meet at Seven Angels in Chilton this coming Saturday at 7 a.m. We're in Acts chapter 11, where Peter has to explain himself why he went into a Gentile's house. Very interesting. Also, please let us know if you watched the broadcast of our Sunday services aired on Spectrum Tuesday evenings at 6 p.m. We're curious to know about that. Is that something? Do we want to go in with other churches and pay a couple of $1,000 for a new transmitter to keep that going? Or is there not enough people watching it to make that worthwhile? Should we focus just on our online ministry? So we're trying to ascertain that. Let us know if that cable ministry on Tuesday nights at 6 o'clock has been a blessing. And this concludes our morning announcements. Let's look to the Lord in prayer. God, we thank you for the blue skies and the sunshine, and that this is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it, and we dedicate it to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
I love to tell the story of amazing things for those who know.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the one holy universal Christian church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
Bonds of prison for me. I'm glory bound, my Jesus to see. For glory to God, he set me free.
Now I am piling higher each day. Baptism of mine has been given away. I either went with a higher ground, and glory to God.
Yeah, he set me free, yeah, he set me free, yeah. He broke the bonds of prison for me. I'm glory bound, my Jesus to see. For glory to God, he set me free.
Goodbye to sin and things that have been found.
Set me free. He broke the bonds of prison for me. I'm glory bound, my Jesus to see. For glory to God, he set me free. He set me free, yeah, he set me free. He broke the bonds of prison for me. I'm glory bound, my Jesus to see. For glory to God, he set me free. Glory to God, he set me free.
Oh, it's good to see you guys. Thank you for coming up. Reason why I'm standing up instead of sitting down is I wanted to show you something. Right here, we have two things in the middle of our altar. Who knows what this is? Does anyone know what this is? Yes. Right, this is the cross. Who knows what this is? Yes, read. The Bible, that's right. And do you guys know why they're in the middle, they're in the center? Because that is the center of our faith. Our faith is built on a foundation of Jesus Christ and the Word of God. That always is at the center. Jesus is the foundation, and the Bible teaches us about Jesus. And that's why we have them there. And not only are they in the center, Jesus should be in the center of your life. And you can ask Jesus to come into your heart, and he will forgive your sins and be your Lord and Savior, and you'll have him here, just like we also have the cross at the center up there. Jesus loves you. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. Amen. And growing up in Judaism, I had to know Deuteronomy chapter 6. I had to recite it in Hebrew 3 times a day. These are the commands, decrees, and laws the Lord your God directed me to teach you, to observe in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to possess, so that you, your children, and their children after them may fear the Lord your God as long as you live by keeping all his decrees and commands that I give you, and so that you may enjoy long life. Hear, O Israel, and be careful to obey, so that it may go well with you, and that you may increase greatly in a land flowing with milk and honey, just as the Lord, the God of your fathers, promised you. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your heart. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for this important text of Scripture that's also repeated and reiterated in the New Testament. And I pray now that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart would be faithful to your word. In Jesus' name, amen. It took 6 months, exactly, March 28th to September 28th, 1999, to build the church parsonage where I live today. But it took the first 50 days to dig the hole, install the footings, pour the cement, and make a strong foundation. And I was starting to wonder, when are they going to get around to building the actual house on top of the foundation? But now on those cold winter nights, when the wind blows in from the west and beats against the house, I thank God for those 50 days. I thank God for that strong foundation. In the same way, God wants us to have a strong foundation on the Word of God. He wants us to be grounded in the Scriptures so that we can stand strong in the midst of the storms and trials and troubles and tribulations of life. Psalm 119, verses 9 through 11. How can a young man keep his way pure? By living according to your Word. I seek you with all my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands. Your word I have hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you. And in Matthew chapter 7, verse 24, Jesus says, whoever hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a man who builds his house upon the rock. And here in Deuteronomy chapter 6, Moses teaches the people of God how they can build their lives on a foundation of Scripture. That's what I want to talk about today. The book of Deuteronomy is a series of speeches given by Moses to the children of Israel as they're getting ready to cross over into the Promised Land. In Deuteronomy 5, Moses reminds the people about the Ten Commandments. And in chapter 6, speaking of the Ten Commandments, Moses says in verses 1 and 2, these are the commands, decrees, and laws the Lord your God directed me to teach you, to observe in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to possess, so that you, your children, and their children after them may fear the Lord your God as long as you live by keeping all his decrees and commands I give you. First thing I notice about that is the repetition of decrees, commands, laws that you should observe. We're to build our lives on a foundation of God's word, God's commands, God's decrees. But another thing I notice is how many times Moses says you and your. So this means that the word of God is not something you can audit. You know, so when I was in seminary, there were some people who took classes with me, but they weren't doing it for credit. They were auditing the class to get the information. But when it was time to graduate, they didn't get the degree. Those who were committed to the class get the degree. Moses says, I want you to be committed to the program. I want you to have a committed, devoted relationship with God. You are not auditing God. You are expected and encouraged to know God for yourself. I heard about a famous actor who was being treated in the hospital. A friend came to see him, and he was surprised to see that the actor was in bed reading the Bible. And the friend said, "Well, I didn't know you were religious. I didn't know that you read the Bible. Are you looking for inspiration?" And the actor said, "No, I'm looking for loopholes." Moses is saying, there are no loopholes. You can't get out of this. This word of God is for you and yours. You say, "Pastor Marc, time out. Romans 6, verse 14 says, you are not under law. You're under grace. So how is this word of Deuteronomy relevant for the church today? Well, good question. It is true, we are not under law. We are under the grace and truth of Jesus Christ. But what does it mean to be under the grace and truth of Jesus Christ? Does that mean that morals and ethics don't count? That we're free to sin as much as we want, as long as we cognitively believe that Jesus is the Son of God? I don't think it means that. Romans chapter 6, verses 1 and 2. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace can increase? By no means. We died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? John MacArthur says, a gospel that does not confront sin is not a true gospel. It's not a gospel of Jesus Christ. And Jesus says in John 14, verse 21, whoever has my commands and obeys them, he is the one who loves me. So obedience to the word of Christ is a sign that somebody really does love Christ and truly is saved and born again by Christ. Here's how I explain this difficult relationship between the Old Testament and the New Testament. We are not under the Old Covenant. But everything in the Old Testament that is repeated and reiterated and restressed by Jesus in the New Testament is timeless. And it is timeless Christian teaching. You say, well, what do you mean, timeless Christian teaching? I thought we were saved by grace through faith alone. We are. You don't keep the teaching and commandments of Jesus in order to be saved by grace through faith. You keep the teaching and commands of Jesus because you are saved by grace through faith, and you love Jesus so much that you don't want to disobey him. You don't want to go against him. You don't want to hurt him. You don't want to rebel against him. All of morality and ethics is motivated out of gratitude and love for Jesus Christ dying on the cross for our sins and rising again. Not only that, we're saved by grace through faith, but what are we saved for? We're saved for a life of obedience. 1 John 2, verse 4, the man who says, I know him, but doesn't do what he says, is a liar. And the truth is not in him. Hebrews 12, 14, make every effort to consecrate yourselves and be holy, because without holiness, no one will see the Lord. So we're saved by grace for obedience and service. You say, okay, Pastor Marc, so why don't you just preach the Ten Commandments out of the New Testament and not out of the Old Testament? Well, number one, I like the book of Deuteronomy. Also, you remember what 2 Timothy 3:16 says? It says, all scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. And at the time Paul wrote all scripture, there wasn't a New Testament yet, so he must have been talking about the Old Testament, especially the book of Deuteronomy. Not only that, Romans 15, verse 4 says, for everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through the endurance and encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. So we can go back to Deuteronomy and books of the Old Testament and through the encouragement of the Word of God, it gives us hope and strength as we live for Jesus under the new covenant today. You say, well, Mark, what about the dietary laws in the Old Testament? Are those timeless? No, those are temporary. Everything in the Old Testament that is not repeated in the New Testament or is repudiated in the New Testament is time-bound, not timeless. So that law in Deuteronomy 14, verse 8, which says you're not allowed to eat pork, I thank God that that's not repeated in the New Testament, because then I wouldn't be able to go to Famous Dave's. I wouldn't be able to have the sweet and sassy St. Louis-style barbecue ribs dripping with sauce and tangy flavor and the muffin next to it and the little corn. I'm sorry. God help me. Well, what did Jesus say in Mark 7:19? He declared all foods clean. He said it's not what goes into a man that makes him unclean. It's what comes out of his heart that makes him unclean. You say, well, what about all those Old Testament laws that talk about animal sacrifices? Jesus Christ fulfilled those laws by becoming the sacrifice to end all sacrifice. Hebrews 10, verse 10 says, we are made holy by the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once and for all. And Hebrews 10, verse 14 says, by one offering, Jesus has made perfect forever those who are being made holy. So some of the stuff in the Old Testament is made timeless by Jesus Christ. Some of it is rendered temporary by Jesus Christ, and some of it was fulfilled in the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Now, the end of Deuteronomy 6, verse 2, talking about building your life on God's word, it says, you should keep the decrees and commands God gives us so that you may enjoy long life. I've noticed personally that life is more enjoyable, more satisfying, and more fulfilling when I'm obeying Christ, when I'm seeking Christ, when I'm staying close to Christ. You say, well, Pastor Mark, what about people out there that I know who don't even believe in God, or they reject God, and they're still living a blessed and long life? That doesn't seem fair. Well, they won't be living a long life for long. Psalm 1:4 says, not so the wicked. They are like the chaff that the wind blows away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment. When you're not following Christ, living a long life might seem like a huge blessing and you're getting one over on God and on Christians. But actually, if you're not a Christian and you're living a long life, you're building up for yourself greater accountability and greater responsibility, because then you're going to have to stand before God and God's going to say, you lived longer than the average and you didn't come to Christ. What's up with that? You say, well, what about the Christians who followed Christ, but they didn't live a long life? They died earlier than we thought that they would. Well, they have something even better than long life. They have eternal life with Jesus Christ. Psalm 16, verse 11, you will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. I was talking to somebody recently who had a miscarriage, and not her first one, and she was heartbroken. And it's always precarious to try to get into a deep philosophical, theological discussion with somebody going through tremendous heartbreaks. I treaded lightly. I said, we don't always know why some people die young and some people die old, but the important thing is that they die in the Lord, and that they go to be with the Lord, and they spend eternity being comforted by the Lord, and they enjoy eternal life with the Lord. Verse 3 says, hear, O Israel, be careful to obey so that it will go well with you. And not only will it go well with you for all eternity if you know the Lord, you may increase greatly in a land flowing with milk and honey. The promised land is rich in resources, milk from the herd and honey from the date palm trees. They've even discovered oil in the promised land. It's loaded with resources, and you can thrive in the land if you know the Lord. And as far as building your life on a foundation of God's word, this brings us to verse 4. It's a very important verse in my life personally because I had to say it 3 times a day in Hebrew. Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. We call this prayer the Shema, the hear. It means there's only one God. Building your life on a foundation of God's word means having a foundational understanding of the oneness and preeminence of Almighty God. Just like I told the kids, the cross and the Bible are at the center of our faith. The one true God should be at the center of our faith. But here's something that a lot of my Jewish family and friends don't know. The word for one, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one, is echad. And it doesn't refer to a Unitarian unity. It refers to a compound unity, two or more united as one. We see the same word in Genesis 2:24. A man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become echad, one flesh. We see the same word in Ezekiel 37, verse 17, when Ezekiel takes two sticks, one representing Israel, one representing Judah, and he joins them together as one, echad. So when it says, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one, Moses is saying that God is two or more persons joined together as one. And we know from later parts of the Bible that he's talking about the Trinity. God exists as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And you're thinking, well, that's no big deal. We've always taught that at Peace Evangelical and Reformed Church. But it is a big deal if all you read is the Old Testament, if you grow up Jewish. It's like, holy cow, I didn't know that about God. I didn't know that there were roots of the Trinity already in the book of Deuteronomy. So there's the value of the Word of God in the Old Testament, that our whole New Testament is grounded in it. Now we go to verse 5. This commandment sums up all 10 commandments from the last chapter. If by the power of the Holy Spirit that lives in you through faith in Jesus Christ, if you can keep this word, the other commandments fall into place. It says, love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your might. In biblical language, the heart is the seat of the emotions. So when Moses says to love God with all your heart, he's saying, I want you to love God fervently and passionately. Recently, I was watching Christian television on channel 49.3 on the antenna, and they were showing a worship service where people were standing up and praising God with great emotion, and tears were streaming down their cheeks. Some would say, you know, that kind of Christianity, those Christians are too emotional and fervent. But where in the Bible does it say it's a bad thing to be emotional? Luke chapter 7, verse 38, a woman comes to Jesus with an alabaster jar of perfume, grieving over her sins, grieving over her mistakes. She kneels at Jesus' feet and pours the perfume on her feet. She wipes his feet with her hair and just worships Jesus with great emotion. And I didn't think she got disciplined for that. I don't remember Jesus saying, well, I was all set to forgive your sins, but you got all emotional on me, so I'm not going to forgive your sins. He didn't say that. You know what he actually said, Luke chapter 7, verse 46. I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven because she loved much. So Jesus affirmed her fervent, passionate, heartfelt love for him. You know, sometimes the same people who say, you know, it's really weird to say praise the Lord in church, a couple hours later, they're going to turn on a Packer game, and they're going to yell at the TV when Davante Adams gives the Packers a 7-0 lead over the Dallas Cowboys. Oops, sorry, Brandon. The Tampa Bay Buccaneers. And you're going to jump off out of your seat and go, yeah, woohoo, yeah. And that's, it's exciting when our team does well. But if you can get pumped up over a game with no lasting eternal significance, then what's wrong with getting pumped up about what God is doing in your life? What's wrong with getting pumped up when it really hits home that Jesus loves you? And just as I am, without one plea, but that my God, he cares for me. Praise the Lord. So it's okay to say praise the Lord. Amen. Let's say it. Praise the Lord. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. But you know what? I also have to say this. Being an emotional person does not necessarily prove that you are a more spiritual person. There are people who worship God quietly and inwardly, and they love God just as much as those of us who say, praise the Lord and amen. It would be judgmental, I think, for me to say, you know what, I was in church and I was pumped up and I was praising the Lord and shouting amen, and you were quiet, so I was more spiritual than you. That would be very ungood. That's not right. Because we're all different. And sometimes we worship differently depending on what's going on in our lives that particular day. Just so happens today I'm pumped up and I'm saying praise the Lord, amen. But there are going to be other times when you don't know what I'm going through and I'm going to want to chill and mellow and in the quietness of my spirit say, I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. I've had a hard week. I need you, Jesus. And I think that's okay too. We're human. Colossians 3:23 says, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart. And I think this is important because building your life on a foundation of Jesus' words means not only studying the word, it means putting into practice the word with the way we worship. Love God with all your heart, and then Moses says, love him with all your soul. The soul is the person we are on the inside. It's the part of us that makes choices and decisions. Loving God with all your soul means making the decision, the intentional decision, to be in church even on the Sundays you didn't feel like getting up out of bed. It means getting up on a weekday morning 15 minutes early, spending time reading scripture, even though you're tired from the night before. You need that word of energy and inspiration and encouragement as you go on with your day. Love God with all your heart, all your soul. And then Moses says, love him with all your might. We do that at Gospel Fest. I don't know what it was about this year's Gospel Fest, but it seemed like we were working harder in the beverage stand than other years. Maybe it's just because I'm 54. I don't know. But it seemed like it was harder. And by the end of the weekend, like the rest of you, I was exhausted. I needed to soak my feet. I could have slept for another 10 hours after that. But you know what? It felt good because I was loving God with my might, with my strength. And that's what all of you were doing at Gospel Fest. I remember, Nancy, you said something like that, I think, when you preached the day after Christmas. I think that's what that means, love him with all your might. So building your life on God's word means learning it, but it also means living it and applying it. I was reading about a man who had an appointment with a surgeon before undergoing surgery. He said, arriving early, I opened the door and I found the surgeon quietly reading a book by the receptionist's desk, and I recognized it as a Bible. When he didn't hear me come in, I cleared my throat. He closed the book, and I asked him, does reading the Bible help you before you do an operation or after you do an operation? And he said, during an operation. So the Word of God not only gives you pep at the time you're reading it, it gives you encouragement and inspiration during the time you're doing whatever it is you're doing. So I want to encourage you first and foremost to make Jesus Christ the Lord of your life, the center of your faith. And then, when you've received Christ as Lord, who died for your sins and rose again, you make the Word of God at the center of your life. And if it's hard to understand, that's why we have these worship services. That's why they make the Life Application Study Bible, which I highly recommend if you don't have a study Bible. But give your life to Christ and allow Christ to give His grace for you. That's what it means to build a life on a foundation of Scripture. Jesus loves you. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. Amen.
He leadeth me,
oh blessed
God,
oh world
is worthy on their side.
Whatever
I meet, his God's hand, he leadeth me.
He
leadeth me, he leadeth me. By His own hand He leadeth me.
His
faithful follower I would be, for by His hand He leadeth me.
Lord, I will clasp Thy hand in mine forevermore.
He leadeth me by His own hand. He
leadeth me. His faithful follower I will be, for by His hand He leadeth me. And when my task on earth is done, when by
let us pray. God, we bring our requests to the throne of grace. We thank you for the reminder of the cross and the Scriptures being at the center. Help us to stay centered on Scripture and on Jesus. We want to pray, Lord, for the joys and the concerns that you've put upon our hearts. We're glad that Lori Anholt's son Michael is doing much better. We thank you, Lord. Continue healing and re-strengthening him. We pray for Lori Krieger. We pray, God, that you would stop the ALS in its tracks and help her to live strong and live the best she can as long as we can, as long as she can. We also pray for Tom and Andy Beshta recuperating at home following a bout with COVID. Help them to find strength and centeredness in Christ. We pray for Amber Bear's cousin, lost a child at 5 months. It's so heartbreaking, Lord. There's no feeling quite like that, the hole that you feel. We pray, Lord, that you would fill that hole in her life. Help her to find strength and consolation in Christ. We pray for Dale and Judy Hernke as they fight COVID. We thank you, Lord, their symptoms are mild and that they would overcome in the name of Jesus. We pray, Lord, for Jean Brammy, heart surgery this week. May the comfort of Jesus be with them. We pray that the surgeon will do an awesome job. Pray for Lynn Stecker as she continues to heal up following hip replacement surgery this week. We pray for my surgery coming up in 8 days. We pray that that goes really well and the doctor does an awesome job and he comes to work wide awake on that Monday morning. We pray, Lord, for the president, the governor, our representatives. We pray, Lord, that you would sovereignly rule and work through them. We thank you that no matter who is occupying the Oval Office, you occupy the throne of heaven and rule sovereignly over the kingdoms of men. Pray for all the unspoken requests in the room, any prayer that may have been overlooked, any concern that may need to be lifted up. Be close to the brokenhearted. Save those who are crushed in spirit. Bless the voices of peace and thank you for their ministry. Most of all, God, we thank you for Jesus, who taught us to pray the Lord's Prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. Amen. I just saw that we also need to pray for Tim, the family of Tim Purr. He died this weekend, and we pray the comfort of Jesus with his family. And now at this time, we'll take up the morning offering.
Life is life. A mountain railway with an engineer that's brave. We must make the run successful from the cradle to the grave. Watch the curve, the hill, the tunnel. Never falter, never fail. Keep your hand upon the throttle and your eyes on the rail. Blessed Savior, thou wilt guide us till we reach that blessed shore where the angels wait to join us in thy praise forevermore. As you roam across the trestle, expanding Jordan's swelling tide, you'll behold the Union depot into which your train will glide. There you'll meet the superintendent, God the Father, God the Son, with a heart joyous greeting, weary pilgrims welcome home. Blessed Savior, thou wilt guide us till we reach the blessed shore, where the angels wait to join us in God's praise forevermore. In thy praise
gifts and help us to use them wisely for ministry. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for worshiping the Lord with us today. I want to leave you with this word of blessing and benediction. Peace to the brothers and sisters in love with faith from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to all who love our Lord Jesus Christ with an undying love. Amen. And God bless you and have a wonderful day and go in peace.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing for sin atone, nothing but the blood of